Welcome to Inside the Arena, your source for everything off the ice, off the court, and outside the field of play. With your hosts, KOMO Sports Director Niko Tamurian and KOMO Senior Reporter Chris Tenz.
Episode number 4, Niko Tamurian. We are back inside the arena, back inside the beautiful KOMO 4 podcast studio.
I love it here.
Good to see you.
It's good to see you. Now, if the Mariners could get rolling, that'd be great.
Oh, I'm going to get to that in a little bit, man. Oh, boy. What a ride that's been in the last week since I last saw.
162-game joyride, ups and downs. Who the heck knows we're going to be in October?
Well, we are talking about not only Mariners baseball. We're talking about the stuff that happens off the field. That's what Inside the Arena is all about. Off the ice, off the court, off the field. We're going to talk about the return of the Sonics. If you have not been with us before, this is really kind of the business of sports, NIL, realignment, TV digital rights deals, construction projects, philanthropic efforts, context you cannot get anywhere else, and we're going to be doing this every week. And this week in particular, we're going to talk a lot about philanthropy with Jaci McCormack, who's the co-founder of Rise Above, a nonprofit that seeks to empower Native American youth through healthy living and basketball. She just held a wonderful youth sports event at Seattle U that you and I attended.
First of all, thanks for introducing me to so many of those folks. What a great organization Rise Above is. For anybody listening, obviously, we'll go deeper on that later in the show, but look them up. And that was great for me to talk with MarJon Beauchamp, originally from Yakima Reservation, an inspiration to youth, not just of Native American descent, but really of anybody, especially here in Western Washington, played his high school ball here in the Seattle area, and of course now going on year 3 with the Milwaukee Bucks. That was a real fun conversation. We're also talking about the LPGA, the Women's PGA Championship, going to Sahalee in Sammamish. Why that is a big deal. Certainly it's a major, but it goes well beyond that with Seattle sports, Chris.
But first, should we touch all the bases? Should we go around the bases, so to speak? Something that we call four corners?
Four corners, let's do it.
All right. How about that crowd noise? Everybody's excited about it. We're going to tell you what's good, what's bad in Seattle sports, local sports. Niko, what do you like this week?
What I like is something that's on the surface isn't great. Okay, so the Coachella Valley Firebirds, the American League affiliate of the Kraken, is now out for a second year in a row. They've lost to Hershey in the Calder Cup final. That is not a good thing. However, what I'm taking from this, Chris, is the fact that we can finally begin this new era of the Kraken in earnest. In other words, now that that season's over, you have Dan Bylsma full attention on the crack. And not that he was slacking or anything like that, but admirably, he wanted to see Coachella through that run, right? So now he's full-time on the Kraken, and we get to learn about the full coaching staff. A huge, intriguing story, Jessica Campbell. Does she become Coachella's head coach, first woman head coach in the AHL? Does she become a Kraken assistant, first woman assistant coach in the NHL? It's going to be history anyway. Look at it, right? It could be anyway. And so I'm excited to see that, but also, we talk about that new era. The draft is coming up Friday. The Kraken has the 8th overall pick. Then they have 2 second rounders, 2 third rounders, one from the Wenberg trade this year, one from a trade from Kelly Yarncroke a few years ago. So you're seeing the vision of Ron Francis, who we talked to, of course, on last week's episode, come into fruition here. So on the surface, not good Coachella loss, but we get to see this new era, coaching staff, the next draft picks, Dan Bylsma full-time in Seattle.
Yeah, no rest for the wicked, no rest for the Kraken in this case with that short turnaround. By the time people are seeing this, hearing this, we may already know some of those answers, but it's one of the things about the NHL season, how long it goes into June, how quickly they have to turn around with the draft and free agency right around the corner. This team could be completely different by the time everybody hears this podcast or sees this show. I'll tell you what I like this week, and I'm going to go with the Sounders. Who, full disclosure, Niko, made me look like a complete idiot. I took my daughter to the game on Saturday, last Saturday, against FC Dallas. They were down 2-0 in the 70th minute. And if you remember the NFC Championship game with the Seahawks and the Packers, I pulled an NFC Championship game. I said, hey, to my daughter, let's get out of here. Let's go beat traffic. And I think if anybody's listening to this podcast and they're a Sounders fan, they know what happened next. The Sounders come down, score a goal. Jordan Morris scores another goal as we're driving home. And then Jordan Morris in extra time hits another goal. And they win 3-2. It was a great goal, by the way, by Jordan.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
But I can tell you that we weren't so happy in the car as we listened to that, realizing that we had just missed a fantastic finish. And it comes at a time, I want to bring this up for people, and we hope to dive into this in the weeks and months ahead, but there was a nice long piece in The Athletic in the past week about the Sounders with owner Adrian Hanauer and the president of business ops, Hugh Weber, talking at length about their plans in Renton. You and I have both been there to the new team facility in the old Long Acres site, which was the Emerald Downs of its day, the old racetrack, later then became Boeing property and now is the property of the Sounders, and that's where they built out their training facility. They talk about that at length in The Athletic, about their ideas for a potential soccer-specific stadium there, maybe a concert venue. They just officially bought the Reign. So there's a lot of things coming together from a business sense for the Sounders right now, and potentially some exciting things to talk about in the months ahead.
Well, we talk about the business impact, and sports is such an economic driver. It always has bugged me when folks see sports in this kind of silo, so to speak, that it's only for entertainment, it's only for this. Well, look no further than what the Sounders, everything you just talked about, are doing in Renton, and the development in that area, the redevelopment of that Long Acre site. It is beautiful. It's state of the art. And that's why sports are so important. You can tell I'm revving up here.
Yeah.
I don't like the negativity I'm seeing from some WNBA fans, specifically on social media,
yeah,
which you really shouldn't even put much stock into, right? I'm not, you know, saying anything that's out of line here, but listen, the fact that we have, like, we talked about silos a minute ago, the fact that you have, like, right now the WNBA is as popular as it's ever been, okay? And I'm not talking about local here. The Storm are doing great. They had that 1-3 start, then they won 7-8. They've been awesome. I'm talking about the national scene. We have these silos, so to speak. You have this group of folks like Caitlin Clark, another group of folks like Angel Reese. Can't we just like them both?
Yes.
Can't we just understand that these are two superstars that are transcending the game, that are driving interest through the roof? Can't we just enjoy what they're giving us?
Yes.
They don't even dislike each other. Why do these fans dislike each other?
I do dislike that it's become some sort of culture war,
yes,
thing with the two of them, and they're both off to pretty good starts. In fact, Angel Reese is having a rookie of the year.
She's incredible. Yeah.
And it's just, it's morphed into something else when I think it should be celebrated.
That's well said. It should be celebrated. They are going to be, you know, the stars of this league, and that's no disrespect to anybody who's out there right now, the Brianna Stewarts, the Jewel Lloyds, the Asia Wilsons. That's no disrespect to them. But we've got something great here. Let's enjoy it.
Well, let me tell you about something that's not so great.
Okay.
As we bring it around the fourth corner, on the negative side, the Mariners, again, thank you for making me look like an idiot. I pointed out on the platform formerly known as Twitter.
Okay.
I think we're supposed to call it X, but everybody still calls it Twitter, despite what the owner of Twitter would like us to say, now X. I pointed out on that platform that it wasn't a misprint, that the Mariners were up 10 games in the AL West, and they proceeded to lose several games in a row.
Six of the last.
And they're stumbling through this road trip.
Let's see what happens, because we've talked about it at length. This window is now for this team before guys get really expensive like Logan Gilbert. Got to strike now. Hold off Houston while you can.
You got to strike now while the Trident is hot or something.
Ooh,
like that.
I like that.
They can use that one next year after Trident's up.
Hashtag Trident's hot.
Okay, let's mix it up this week, yeah, and talk about a team that isn't here first. In the supersonic minute, we've gone longer than a minute on this segment over the last few weeks. So, Niko, we can probably sum it up pretty quickly. No major updates in the TV digital rights deal, which is what a lot of people are watching here in Seattle. Sounds like we could be now a few weeks away from having a formal announcement by the NBA. And once that is done, NBA Commissioner Adam Silver has already signaled that he is going to turn his attention to expansion. And I know there have been investors that have been kicking the can, so to speak, here in Seattle with meetings and prep calls about what that potentially looks like, how much money they're trying to put together for the expansion fee. And it sounds like we still have some work to for that deal to get done before we can talk about expansion. But we're going to update people every week.
Every
in that
week.
Minute.
Listen, it's been 16 years. What's another few weeks, right?
Yeah. Well, and, you know, it's a great transition to get to the idea that, Niko, you talked to a guy who was just 8 years old when the Sonics left.
Yeah, and I love MarJon Beauchamp's story, and I think it was really cool that we were able to catch up with him. We mentioned it a moment ago. This is a guy born in Yakima on the Yakima Reservation and is thrived, played his high school ball here in Seattle, and of course now is in the NBA, third year of the Milwaukee Bucks. He came back from Crawford's crossover event the night when LeBron James, Jason Tatum, all those folks were here. And it just shows this, you know, I love that night because in addition to being in the NBA, it's like this guy who has just persevered and grown up in our backyard is suddenly on that stage with the LeBrons and Jason Tatums of the world. But this was a cool conversation because we talked about that rise, making it to the league. But in addition, about the Sonics and what his NBA teammates, coworkers, everybody you want to talk about in the league is saying about the hopeful and potential return of the Sonics. Here it is.
Well, here with MarJon Beauchamp. Hey, thanks so much for the time. We appreciate you. Welcome back. And let's just talk about these first couple years here now. Everything's going for you in the league. Dream come true, I'm sure. Just what's it like every time you're out there living that dream you've had since you were a kid?
Yes, it's just crazy. You know, it's been a journey just to get where I am. And, you know, just being in the NBA for 2 years already, you know, it goes by fast. As you can see, I'm going in year three. And, you know, I've learned so much and I'm around great vets, you know, with the Milwaukee Bucks and great organization. And, you know, I just feel like I've been growing every year. So it's just, it's been a blessing. And yeah, it's definitely surreal now, you know, just my reality. And, you know, it's just crazy to be, you know, where I remember this being, you know, literally just watching TV like, dang, I want to be in the NBA one day, you know, and I'm kind of here now. Oh, I am here.
Oh, you're definitely here, and you're making so many people proud.
Yeah.
How much do you feel you've grown, not just as a basketball player, but as a man, as a person?
You know, I feel like everything I've been through, you know, just made me who I am today, you know, just made me appreciate every opportunity I get from, you know, from there. And then, you know, just growing up, I feel like I didn't really have many role models to look up to, you know, like my grandpa was one of them, you know, and my dad, of course, but, yeah, it's just great to, you know, be that figure for, you know, the community in Seattle, Yakima, you know, where I'm from, and just try to, you know, set the best example for them, you know.
And that's exactly what I was going to ask next, is that you were watching these guys play one day. Now you are those guys, the kids here in Seattle and Yakima are watching. What does that mean to you, that you're giving so many people an example, a goal, all that?
Nah, it's definitely, you know, it's this guy's work. I feel like, you know, he put me in this position for a reason, and I'm just trying to be the best me I could be for them, you know, and try to give them hope and faith and just to be whatever, not just a basketball player, you know. There's a million things they can do in this world, and I feel like you just got to go after your dreams and never stop going, even when, you know, you hit trials and tribulation.
And talking about our state specifically, you've heard the commissioner kind of hint around expansion, right? You're smiling about it. Like, what would that mean to have the Sonics back now that you're?
Oh, man. I feel like Seattle is the place, you know, to have a team for sure. And I didn't grow up having the Sonics. Well, I was in Yakima, but like, just being here for 3 years. From my high school, it's definitely a basketball town, you know, and I think we definitely need that back.
And we talked about kids a minute ago growing up, and then there's a generation of them in Seattle that didn't have that NBA team that so many others did. Yeah. How much of a game changer do you think that would be for the game here in town?
Yeah, I think it's going to be a big game changer, you know, kids, you know, going to the games and just seeing it, you know, not like, I bet like a lot of kids in Seattle, like, haven't been to an NBA game, you know, and they can have an opportunity to, you know, go to a game and see it and feel it, you know, and it might give them inspiration to, you know, go for those dreams.
I just got to ask, do teammates, other guys in the league, when they see an article about expansion, because there's been so many, right? Do they ever mention, like, oh, what's it like after they ever talk about, like, the Sonics come back? What's the,
I know Brooke Lopez, like, this is one of his favorite cities, you know, he loves Seattle, so, That's probably like the only one I heard. Like he was like, yeah, they need a team, man. Like that's a beautiful city, and they definitely need a team.
Yeah, so you'll be kind of like the Washington State tour guy if there's ever games up here.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, hey, whether it's as a visitor or one day as a Sonic, we can't wait to see it come up.
Yes, sir.
Thanks for your time. Appreciate you.
Thank you.
Yeah, that was a great conversation. Brooke Lopez can be a Sonic any day he wants. So can MarJon. And, you know, listen, yeah, that's cool to hear that those guys talk about that. And when we see those mock potential future expansion drafts, it's cool to see whether it's former Sonics like Jeff Green or the many Seattle area natives in the league right now, that it's there to dream about they could be Sonics one day.
It's crazy to think, and Jamal Crawford has done a great job over the years with crossover, bringing these players back, bringing kids back that were walking around at 4, 5, 6 years old, didn't know really what about the Sonics leaving Seattle. Now they're in the NBA, and now they're saying, hey, do I get to go play in my hometown? And Jamal, I think, should be credited with keeping people interested, keeping that community built, and people like MarJon wanting to come back for that event. And you know this. We did that interview. You did that interview at the Rise Above Sports Fest, which was at Seattle University. Continues to grow thanks to Jaci McCormack, who we mentioned off the top, and Brad Myers, who co-founded that organization to help Native youth, in particular kids keeping active, keeping them engaged in school. There were a bunch of former Sonics that were there, including Dale Ellis, who comes back to Seattle quite a bit to help with Rise Above. Sean Kemp was there. The great Lenny Wilkins, who we featured in episode 3, was there. Detlef Schrempf, he was there for a moment. We saw a lot of folks that people would recognize at that Rise Above Sports Fest. And we also sat down with Jaci about the growth of her organization really over the past decade and the work that she is doing with young people. You and I saw it firsthand how she's engaging with the kids in that camp. Let's hear from her now.
Jaci, good to see you again.
Yes, good to see you.
You've had a heck of a year with Rise Above, Seattle Sports Commission honoring you, and still the word is getting out about what you're doing and what your background is and the movie that's being made about your life. There's a lot that goes into Rise Above and your backstory. So for people who have not heard your backstory, how did you get involved with basketball? Why and why basketball?
Well, I was just really blessed. I was raised by my grandparents, and they were into sports. They played all sports. So I was just blessed to be able to be exposed to a lot of team sports growing up, and just really fell in love with basketball. Really fell in love with competition, but absolutely love basketball. And it was just kind of like, I know it probably sounds cheesy, but like really my saving grace, right? Like anytime that I was stressed, under pressure, needed some alone time, basketball was my piece, and just kind of took it from there.
How is it a saving grace growing up in reservation communities and Native communities? How was this a saving grace for you?
Well, I think for me, you know, it just relieves pressure, but also it's a community builder. People come together, and basketball sport is just a uniter. And when you go to a basketball tournament or a basketball game on smaller reservations, the gym is packed. You know, sometimes there's just the gym is so packed that it's, you know, standing room. It hasn't happened in a long time at Lapway, but like back in the day, like, you know, growing up, I watched our teams growing up and standing room only in the gyms. But basketball is just one of those uniting things that people come together, families come together. It's just an easy way for us to connect, and I say that now it's cultural. It's a part of our culture. It's a part of who I am.
It got you a college education too.
Yes, absolutely. You know, I was raised by my grandparents, and there wasn't really a lot of options for me, you know, going to college. And so I knew getting a college scholarship was going to be able to really balance that out and give me more opportunity. So when I got a full ride to Illinois State, just a blessing in so many ways, exposing me to new cultures, new people, new environments, new experiences. I just always say that basketball is really a piece of everything that we do at Rise Above.
And you hit a big shot or something, right? That Illinois State.
Yeah.
There's a framed photo I've seen.
Yeah. You know, I tell the kids a lot about that. And I always say, I don't tell you this to impress you, but to impress upon you to have goals, right? So for 5 years, I redshirted my sophomore year. I did the whole like ESPN, you know, we had the countdown. I didn't made my teammates countdown all the time for 5 years, right? I had this vision of I wanted to make ESPN, and then ESPN not top 10 came out. And I was like, you know what? I'll take it. You know, I'll take ESPN not top 10. And, you know, I was just blessed to, you know, put in a position to be able to take the shot. It went in, and, you know, my goal and my vision really came to life. And I tell the kids that because you have to have a goal or a vision. Doesn't matter what that is, but you have to be able to see it first, right? So it was a fun way to end my career for sure, senior year.
And there's like a whole movie that's in the works on this.
There is.
Danny Glover.
Yeah. You know, when I say bless, I use bless a lot. And I don't want to say overuse it, but I truly feel grateful, humbled, blessed. And when you have two people like a Lenny Wilkins, three-time Hall of Famer, Seattle icon, right? Seattle legend. And Danny Glover, who has given back most of his life. Two people investing in you and your organization, but as mentors, I mean, it doesn't get any better than that. And they've really come on to really support the film, but really the film is another way to attract kids to share our stories and empower them that they could, you know, dream big dreams and do things that they didn't think that they could do.
I know this, but a lot of people don't, just how long you've been working to really build up Rise Above. I've seen it from the ground level. We're at an event today where there's twice as many kids, it seems like, that there were the year before. But why did you start this organization, this nonprofit?
You know, it was really lack of representation. When I was growing up, I didn't have that person to really emulate and look up to and say, I want to be like her or I want to be like him. And when I went to college at Illinois State, I was like, you know, I have to find a way to get back. And I didn't know what that meant as an 18-year-old kid. It was a moment of clarity for me, but I didn't know what that meant. But at the end of the day, like, I think that, you know, when you're passionate about something, when you truly love something, you want to give back, things happen in life. And I'm a big believer in things happen for a reason. I met Brad, oh gosh, like 15 years ago, and we co-founded Rise Above. We're about to start year 10. And really it comes from lack of representation, but also giving kids an outlet, an opportunity. And at the end of the day, I believe it's just about hope for our Native youth.
And it's taken you all around the country now. I've seen you've been in Wisconsin with Vin Baker. You've been in Denver and with George Carl. You're now working with a group in Oklahoma. I mean, you've really been branching out as time goes on.
Yes. You know, we say that it's a lot easier to work with like-minded and like-mission people. And Vin Baker, what an amazing human, wanting to give back, using his own story of recovery and resilience, really, to teach kids that you can overcome things. And, you know, went to North Carolina, Denver, Oklahoma, Portland.
I left a few of those out.
Yeah. But that's all in 2024. So in the first quarter of 2024, we've served more kids or just as many kids in the first quarter than we have in an entire year. And that's just a blessing for us to be able to reach more kids, share a message, and just really build a community.
What do you tell these kids? I've seen you in action go around to each of these kids to get a verbal commitment from them. What is that all about?
Yeah, well, we start the camp with, you know, I want you to fail. Because I think right now kids are afraid to fail. They're afraid to be on social media. They're afraid to put themselves out there. Because what if I try hard and I miss? Like, so what? You know, you fail more times, you're going to be successful. So we start the camp out with, I want you to fail. And it kind of breaks down that like perfection, you know, model that we all see. And at the end of the camp, you know, Native kids suffer from a suicide rate of 2.5 times the highest national average. So my goal is really to let them know that there's a room filled with people who care about them and that they make a promise to me. I make the same promise to them that if I feel that I'm overwhelmed, having some self-harming thoughts or some negative thoughts that are going to take me down a path that maybe I don't want to go down, that they promise me that they're going to reach out to somebody. And I will do the same, that, you know, before you engage in anything, that you promise, just reach out to one person. And if you don't have that one person, that I'm here and our Rise Above team is here.
How important do you think your organization is? And this is a this is a question you're going to nail out of the park, but how important do you think this organization is right now in tribal communities? Because there have been a lot of issues away from the court, whether it be with fentanyl and overdoses. We've seen it in the Lummi tribe, we've seen it Tulalip. To have your organization going out of the community and keeping kids active, how important do you think it has been over the last several months?
I truly believe that we're saving lives. And when we can talk to the kids about some of those decisions that they're going to be faced with, that there's people out there that will help them, that will love them, that care about them. But on the flip side of that, it's like we all make mistakes, right? Even today. I mean, we're all human. We make mistakes. But how, as a young person, if I make a mistake, how do I correct my path, right? And it's not so much telling them that you're never going to make a mistake. It's like, we're all going to make a mistake. How do you get back on track after that mistake happens? Or how do you have the right tools to be able to say no to somebody, understand what somebody is presenting you, but at the end of the day, like, you know, we truly are saving lives. And when you talk about, you know, the back end and treatment, you know, you probably saw a sign out there for every dollar you invest in prevention, early intervention, you're saving $18 on the back end, and you're also saving lives. So our shift, our focus is really prevention, early intervention. How do we get the kids the skills and the resources to not make those decisions when they're presented to them?
So you're almost at year 10. What's the next 10 look like?
Oh, man. I have so many big dreams for Rise Above. My big dream is really a Rise Above Academy at some point. Graduation rates in Washington State are 60%, and those numbers haven't changed for our Native youth in a really long time. And how do you change a generation of kids? Education. And so that's my goal for Rise Above, is brick and mortar, have some space in Seattle, have a place where kids and community can go and really feel embraced and feel loved.
I'm optimistic for the future of Seattle, thanks to people like Jackie, and also what we're hearing from folks like the LPGA commissioner, president and CEO of the Seattle Sports Commission. I want to hear what they have to say, especially on the heels of the Women's PGA Championship.
Seattle is a great city for women's sports. I mean, we have a WNBA team here, an NWSL team. The fans come out. We looked at the statistics when we're looking at, you know, how many fans are we going to have out this week, and we see that they're among the top in both of those leagues in terms of attendance. And that's really important to us when we think about what we're trying to accomplish. We want people to turn on that TV and see big crowds with people with their arms up in the air cheering for the best players in the world. So coming to a city that values women's sports, and we know the fans are going to come out and watch, is really important.
When they are considering host cities as a prospect, they are considering, have they hosted other events before? Have they been successful? Has the experience for the fan and the players been something that is extraordinary? And because we have continued to deliver on that promise, that has just made us more of a destination and something that these leagues and governmental bodies are really keeping an eye on Seattle and saying, we want to head out there.
So that's my final buzzer.
Wait. We have to use the... We're going to try and get this all in the final buzzer. And by the way, we're going to talk a lot with Beth Knox over the coming months.
Yes.
And all the events that she is planning for here in Seattle. But what's your final thought here?
The future is bright. You may see the Women's PGA Championship as its own thing, but it's not, because there's been the MLB All-Star Game the year before, the World Cup coming, all the things we talk about in the big events, and Seattle keeps passing these tests with flying color. The future is so darn bright, and we passed another one with a major event here just last week with the golf.
And final thought from me, Ann McCoy, named the Washington State University Athletic Director. She is losing the interim tag. She is a friend of the program, having already appeared here on Inside the Arena. By the way, we are now a 3-point play. You know this, right?
Yes, I did.
We're audio on all these different audio platforms. We're on YouTube, and now on ARC Seattle, we've made it. Three different platforms, three different types of platforms.
This is why the interim tag was removed from Ann McCoy. There's no question.
There's no question. All right, on that, let's hand it off to David.
You've been listening to Inside the Arena with Niko and Chris. Please subscribe on your favorite platform. Until next time.